PR and popcom domain has gone through tremendous transitions, you know, since the past one decade now, and more so in the past 10 months, right? So, you know, seamlessly transitioning and adapting to these changing scenarios were the PR professionals. And today we have with us Ms. Ritika Johari. She is Senior Director, Strategic Partners Group. And we are delighted to have you in our second episode of the E4M PR and Popcom Next Gen series, where we will talk and celebrate the win of PR leaders, upcoming leaders who have been into you know, the E4M PR and Popcom 40 under 40 elite list. So welcome, Ritika. And we are really glad to have you today with us.
Thanks, Nafisa. Thanks for the lovely introduction also. And I'm excited to be part of this and just share some of the learnings I've gained, you know, in the past few years, as in more than 16 now, since I've been with this wonderful, wonderful industry.
So, you know, my first question would obviously be, how do you feel about winning this elite title and being with the leaders of the PR and popcom industry, the elite list of, you know, 40 under 40.
Absolutely. I mean, it's truly a pleasure because, you know, one, it kind of reinforces the fact that, you know, somewhere you're doing the right things. And secondly, it is a motivation. So, you know, it motivates you to continue on your path, learn more, gain more knowledge, and especially being on the same platform with so many people with whom we have been working and, you know, exchanging knowledge. So it's truly a great feeling. So something good in 2020 is this.
Good in 2020, of course. You know, see, like I started in the intro that, you know, the industry has gone through a lot of changes and, you know, people have adapted to work in these, you know, changed environments. So what, according to you, are the key skills required in the prevailing market?
Sure. So, see, as a PR person, one, the key skill that is required is you need to be a storyteller, a natural storyteller who can tell the story in the most creative and compelling manner. Because I think that is the core. And I don't think this skill can be, you know, you will not be inborn with this skill, but yes, you know, you need to be a person who is able to visualize things, he's able to connect with people and then, you know, transform stories. But more important for you to be a successful storyteller is to really, you know, understand the purpose, you know, by for which you are telling the story. So all communication has to be led by purpose. So you need to be clear and have those answers in place. What is the purpose of my story? Who am I trying to reach out to? And what is my call to action? What do I want them to do? So then, you know, then only you can be an effective storyteller. So I keep telling my team that, you know, associate yourself with what you are telling. Think as a listener also, whether you will be emotionally, you know, kind of interested in this particular story, whether you will do that call to action that you are aiming for or not. Secondly, I think the other important thing which is emerging now is, you know, having an analytical mind. You know, data and analytics have emerged big time. You need to have the right set of proof points. So whenever you go for your pitches, whenever you're telling your client that, okay, this is my campaign, this is my strategy, you cannot just make motherhood statements. You need to have your proof points. You need to have your evidence. And after that, you also need to, you know, be able to tell that, okay, this has been the impact of my campaign after you have successfully run it. So you need to be able to crunch, mine data and analyze it for the benefit of yourself. If you are not able to do that in today's day and age, somewhere you will be lost in the clutter. So yeah, I mean, I think, of course, these two are the key things that have emerged right now. But the other thing that always stayed was, you know, having that industry knowledge. You cannot be a delivery boy. You cannot be like, you know, initially it used to happen that, you know, we are taking, you know, printouts and just going and saying that, okay, this is a press release. No, you have to understand the industry, whatever sector you are, you know, kind of working in, as in PR, you will be handling multiple clients, so different sectors, but you need to do your homework. You need to be well-read. You need to be well-connected, because only then you can be that knowledge partner for your client. You know, you cannot expect the client to tell you what to do and you just do it. No, you have to have that first-hand information. And in fact, many times, think ahead, you know, of the client and give him that information that, you know, kind of keeps them alert, keeps you alert, and also strengthens the position of your client within his system. Because he would know things, you know, like what you have told him in advance. So that is a benefit. That is an asset. And we cannot miss out on that. So yeah, I mean, these I think are the key skills right now, and many more to be added, but yes, these three are the key.
So according to you, purpose-based storytelling, along with being strong on analytical data and being well-read and well-informed, are the key skills.
Absolutely, you summed it up really well. So purpose-led communications, yes.
Okay, and you know, the 40 under 40 list really talks about the upcoming leaders or the leaders who have done tremendously well in the industry. So you have been a leader and you have been running this Stag Asia group as a senior director since a long time. So according to you, what are the basic or the required skills to be a leader?
Absolutely. So I think skills required to be a leader, again, I would say that, you know, you need to drive communication. So you need to know your sector, your industry very well, because only then you can drive and you can, you know, kind of lead by example. So even if you have a team, you know, so for example, I'll just give you an example. So we at SPAG, we are largely entrenched into healthcare. So it is expected that, you know, we would understand the healthcare domain really well. And I think that is what, you know, this is something that has helped us excel, because many times we are able to, you know, engage with the client at a very, very, you know, deep level, wherein we are able to give insights, we are able to give the guidance, you know, that is definitely valued by the clients, you know, when it comes to healthcare. So our knowledge is not superficial. Plus, of course, you know, in the team, we have people who are from the medical background, people who can do the right kind of content. So having that purpose-built team and working with them is, you know, is another skill that every leader needs to have. So we need to know that, okay, what is the kind of team that I need to have for this particular campaign, which can complement each other? So, you know, we don't need to have people who have the same skill set. You know, I may not be having something which I think, you know, my team member will be able to value add for me and deliver results to the client, right? So that is something, you know, having, being able to visualize, defining the right mix of team members that you want and work with them to deliver results is definitely an important thing. And being well connected, well entrenched into the industry to lead by example is another key thing that you need to do as a leader. And I think at SPAG, we've done that well, especially in healthcare.
Okay. So let's, you know, break the tone of the conversation. A lot of serious talks have happened. How has been your interaction with your team in these past 8 to 9 months? You know, you guys are working from home. We are also working from home, and this is a very good example of this. So how has been your interaction with the team, and what new skills or maybe, you know, new things that you have learned about your team during these months? This is also a thing, my team has it, let's use it accordingly.
Absolutely. That's a very nice question, Nafisa. So, you know, one thing I want to congratulate each one of us, you know, you, me, everyone is, we are really agile. You know, we were able to kind of, you know, shift to the new ways of working pretty quickly. I'll tell you, you know, 6th March was my birthday and we were celebrating in office and we were having fun. We never thought that, you know, this thing could happen. Next week, we were discussing that, you know, cases are increasing. Maybe let's do a work from home for another week and then evaluate. And after that, we have not gone back to office. But let me tell you, there was not even one single dull day at work. Because everybody, you know, very quickly shifted to platforms like Teams, Zoom, everything. And, you know, we were having discussions which were much more productive. People, you know, were saving their time to, you know, come to office, getting, you know, ready for office. Of course, they used to get ready and, you know, we wanted that discipline. But, you know, at least there was some kind of time saving. They also had time to spend with their family. And so it was definitely, you know, productive. But I don't want to take away that in the beginning, it was challenging because whenever there is change, you have to adapt to it. So, you know, people were going through an emotional turmoil also, because I'll tell you, in my team, there were several members who were, you know, staying away from their home in PGs. It was very difficult for them to do that. I had to provide that emotional support also, you know, as a team leader. I think that is extremely important. So we used to have conversations like, you know, so every day, apart from work, having the job list ready and everything, we used to have these random conversations also. We did virtual parties, congratulatory parties, you know, whenever, because I'll tell you, there was this thing in my team. So whenever we got something really good, we used to do this Bhangra step. But now, I mean, you're not there physically. So how do you do it? So we used to host these evening parties and, you know, on Zoom, on virtual, I made sure that I used to get ready. So, you know, there was this particular dress that I had chosen that I will take it for my tour. That couldn't happen. So fine, I'll share that stuff with my colleagues, and why not? So all these things, you know, matter a lot. So it was good. It was challenging, but it was fun and we've been successful. So it's nice.
Awesome. I think all these things by the leaders and the team have, you know, kept everyone working together and evolve as an industry altogether.
Absolutely.
So talking on your personal front, Ritika, how has been your life at home? You know, you've been working also and you have been handling household, of course, with everyone in your family. How has that experience been for you?
Very nice. I mean, so I'll tell you, my husband is a banker. Okay, so he never could stay at home. You know, he was working throughout, right? So it was like, okay, now I have to, you know, kind of work from home. You have to go to office. Your thing never changes. So how do we manage it? But I think it's great because we divided our course. We ensured that, you know, there is no disruption in the way the house is functioning. Even though we did not have house helps at that time, we don't have like a 24 hours. So everything had to be done by us. So we ensured that, you know, everything is taken care of. My husband used to do his part of the thing and then go to office. We kind of took some shortcuts in cooking, but then eventually we went on to do some very elaborate cooking also. Fortunately for me, my son, you know, also helped me a lot. He also had to be managed because he had to shift to online ways of learning. That also had its own challenges. We had to, you know, kind of really do that counseling for him so that, you know, he doesn't go into a shell. He's not able to meet his friends. So all of that. But I think as a team, we, you know, we managed it really well. We spent some good moments together as well. We used to play a lot of, you know, board games after our offices were over, because we cannot let our office work hamper, you know, the child, you know, because he's not able to go out with friends. So we had to be his friends. We had to ensure that we make time for it. And so, yeah, it was managed well. And I'm happy that, you know, I did not break down. It was challenging for me, but I managed. And sometimes I do feel that, you know, superwomen, we are in some ways or the other, Nafisa.
We all sailed through the difficult times and now we have adapted to it. And so, Ritika, moving on to my next question, which definitely has to be about digital and the digital amplification of everything around. You know, everything now is digital. It was there earlier also, but now everything has been amplified. So how have you used digital as a, you know, format to, you know, help your clients in your PR services? Or maybe what have been the different trends that digital had seen during these past 10 months? Just enlighten us with some of your key findings.
Absolutely. So I think, you know, what had happened was that the PR industry had started to witness a lot of change, you know, when it comes to technology, a lot of disruption that we could see is happening. Now, so what we had already started to do was, you know, to tell our clients that how the way people are consuming news is changing and you need to move to other methods. So, you know, you need to be channel agnostic. You cannot just do pure play editorial media. You need to have social media amplification and, you know, different formats of storytelling. Then you need to, you know, kind of do online PR. But what happened, you know, was with this pandemic, I think, you know, we could emphasize, you know, more than ever on what we had, you know, kind of thought of, right? So our clients also started to now feel that, no, I think this is right. The time is ripe to actually move to more innovative ways of, you know, letting our agency, letting our PR partners do the storytelling. So we were, you know, able to make them understand that how the media ecosystem is evolving. Let's go and, you know, kind of own the, you know, e-media space. So that was happening. And the opportunity was immense because we could do the storytelling in so many different formats. We could connect with the audience, you know, better. So especially, I think, videos, you know, the trend of doing the storytelling via videos emerged and was utilized really, really well, I must say. In fact, you would remember that, you know, after the lockdown was getting better and the airports were getting ready to let the flights move. So there were a lot of videos during the rounds wherein they were showing that, you know, how everything is properly sanitized. There's, you know, all the safety guidelines are being followed. So I think that connected really well. So, you know, I'm just giving you an example that how every, you know, industry vertical, how every brand chose to tell the story via videos and, you know, video news releases, because you could not have physical events. You could not have, you know, press conferences. So a lot of webinars happened, you know, so we were, you know, very quick in telling to our clients that, okay, if you are not able to do the pure play media because of the focus on COVID, let's do webinars with, you know, whoever, you know, in our case, maybe a few doctors to spread awareness and, you know, stuff like that, because it's very important to connect with all your stakeholders. And in our case, when it comes to, you know, as a healthcare specialist firm, for all our clients, one of the key stakeholders is the doctors. One of the key stakeholders is also the consumer. So you need to keep them engaged even during this time when you are not able to deliver media. So we had to do that innovative thinking, reach out to them so that they know that, okay, these are the additional services that my communications partner can provide during this time and how the emerging trends can be utilized. You know, there is an opportunity. How you can change the challenge, you know, to an opportunity. So I think we were agile enough to do that and it worked in our favor. So yeah, a lot of trends, and these trends are now here to stay. It's not like midterm or short term. These are here to stay. And it's all good for the PR industry.
Of course, these trends are here to stay. And you know, if I ask you about your clients, so how have their, I will not say the word attitude, but how has been their outlook towards the PR services? Have they become more receptive, or they have become more acceptable of your advices or anything? What has been your clients, what should be the right word? How has your clients behaved during these months? Finding or acceptable or receptive, or what was them?
Okay, so Nafisa, let me, you know, kind of put this question into perspective. So, you know, these have been difficult times for us as well as our clients. Mm-hmm. We as their partner, if you remember in my first response that, you know, the key skills that are required, you know, you need to be a knowledge partner. You need to be a partner, communications partner for your client. And, you know, in line with that role, what we ensured was to give that comfort level to the clients, because definitely this was a challenging time for many of our clients also, because you know, the businesses were not doing that well. You know, what they had thought for the year, you know, the goals, the objectives, both in terms of numbers, you know, they found it difficult, you know, and to a lot of things, you know, a lot of events or product launches were planned, but they could not happen, right? So we had to step in at the right time before our client could give us like a distress call. We had to be, you know, kind of do that forward thinking and give them a call and go back to them with the other innovations or other solutions that we could do in this meantime. So that is what, I meant when I said that, you know, we had to definitely be vigilant to the fact that, for our clients, there are so many stakeholders, they need to keep engaged every time. So whether it is a dull time for their business, still they need to be, to keep them engaged, whether it is the consumers, whether it is the, the doctors, their customers, doctors or anyone, basically the customers for a business. So how will you keep them engaged? So is there an activity that you can do? Is there, any kind of virtual event that you can do? Actually invest into some kind of social media activity that will keep them engaged, give them that visibility that you're not able to gain on traditional media. So fortunately for us, we did not face a lot of, difficulty or misbehavior from the clients, because we kind of preempted that and reached out to all our clients and kind of had those discussions wherein we could make them feel comfortable that fine, this is a challenge, but this is how we can actually leverage and do, what is the need of the hour.
So it was more of a symbiotic relationship, both parties supporting each other, sales through these difficult times.
Absolutely. And this is where, as a communications professional, you need to be, doing that forward thinking. You don't wait till your client tells you that nahi kuch nahi ho raha. You need to preempt, do that call that, okay, this is what we think. So again, the problem solving attitude. So instead of highlighting the problem, what is the solution or what can be done is what we as a communication partner need to offer to our clients.
Of course. And are we technologically ready, or is the PR industry technologically ready to adapt to become, fully virtual in the times to come?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, I must say. Yeah. And like I said, that, the testimony to it is that how quickly we could adapt to the new ways of working, in just about most of us did not even get a full week to kind of re-energize, re-channelize, kind of redo the way we were working. So I think we are fully prepared, and technology will have a huge role to play. And this is an opportunity, because I'll tell you, as PR professionals, as we are natural storytellers, so we need to, we are very good at understanding the other person's perspective. But if we get tools, highly advanced digital or technology tools that helps us in understanding our consumers better, it is going to be a win-win, because once you understand your consumer better, you will be able to tell a story in a way that is appreciated by your consumer. And therefore, you will be able to realize your objectives. You will be able to deliver business impact, because no campaign can be successful until you have been able to reach to your consumers most effectively and showcase business impact.
And the best part would be a better ROI, right?
Absolutely. And, if you talk about technology, right? So we have so many new tools coming in for real-time monitoring of, what is happening in the media discourse, right? Social media, traditional media. So you are very well connected. Then, like you said, ROI. So a lot of tools are coming in wherein we can measure the impact of our campaign, because that has been a challenge. You are now not using advertising value and stuff like that. You need to showcase what has been the real-time impact of your campaign. So there are a lot of tools coming out for that. And then, of course, like I said, the way you are telling your story. So whether it is through videos, augmented reality, everything. I mean, you can, the floor is there for you to, kind of use to your benefit. Truly, these are most exciting times, I think, you know, for us.
And you know, talking on the similar line, what according to you will be, you know, some of the innovations or key innovations that will shape up the future of PR and Corp industry?
Absolutely. So I think, you know, one key thing that comes to my mind and we need to know more about it is, you know, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, cloud computing. I mean, these are the some of the innovations that will really change the way in which we are, you know, kind of strategizing, in which, you know, the way we are conceptualizing campaigns and delivering, you know. So I think this definitely is an innovation that will come out. Then, you know, data analytics, so big data, generating that data so that you can measure the impact of your campaign is something that, you know, we have been, you know, kind of looking at, struggling. So I think we are quite close to getting new and better tools for doing that. So that is an innovation that will help a lot of PR and communication professionals to actually, you know, call out the impact of a campaign, because I think that is really, really important. And innovations, I think, in user experience, because like I said, the way people are consuming news is really, really changing. So, you know, how does your website look like? How does your, you know, how have you packaged your story? What is the user experience will matter a lot, you know? So, yeah, and I think, Nafisa, one trend I want to talk about here is also that, you know, I really wanted to talk about, and I have seen it growing, is, you know, role of the influencers, because, you know, that is becoming huge, you know, because everything is digital. You see so many influencers, youth influencers, social influencers, you know, kind of, you can engage with them in such an effective manner to reach out to an audience, you know, to the consumers who can be influenced by those influencers. So I think influencer marketing is really going to be big. And for any stakeholder, you know, whether if you're engaging with the government, your influencers will be different, but you will need to have those influencers. If you're engaging with the mass communication or the youth, your influencers will be different, but, you know, you will have to engage with them. So that is something that you cannot miss out on.
Okay, so influencer marketing, empathy-based marketing, you know, communication, taking up everything around us would be definitely trending in the, you know, years to come. So moving on to, you know, my last question, or that should not be a question indeed. This is, what would be your message to your juniors or your colleagues out there who will be listening to this video on how to take the industry forward? What should be the outlook towards life and work? Your key message to your PR professionals.
You know, firstly, we all must know that the future is bright. And I think the PR industry, the communications industry, is envisaging a very, very important role. You know, if you know now, in fact, you know, the business objectives, the PR objectives are getting tied with the business and organization goals, because they kind of realize the importance of communications in achieving their business objectives. So this is an opportunity that is there for everyone to, you know, harness, to leverage. And that is why, like I said, to my team members, to everyone who's, you know, who's aspiring to make it big in this industry, is that, you know, we need to be very well connected with what is happening around us, you know, what is happening in the industry, what are the new methods of storytelling that are coming, you know, kind of really, really being, because that is important to be that knowledge partner to your clients. You know, I know it doesn't sound really nice, but you cannot be a delivery boy. You need to be that knowledge partner. You need to gain that trust of your client. And for that, you will need to do your homework, do that research, and be up to date, you know, with whatever information you have.
Well, I believe everyone who will be listening to this will definitely abide by your advices and suggestions. And once again, thank you so much, coming and doing this video interaction. And we again wish you congratulations and all the very best for your future. Thank you so much, Ritika.
Thank you, Nafisa. I really enjoyed talking. Thank you.